You want to site your data center in close proximity to existing, dual gas transmission lines. So obviously, your end user, your hyperscaler, is wanting your N plus one. What sort of redundancies do we have to offer, right? So having access to just not just one gas line, but two is great.
Hey, welcome back inside our proactive newsroom. And joining me now is Will Gray. He is the CEO of New Era Helium. And Will, it's great to see you again. How are you?
You're doing well, Steve, yourself.
I'm doing well. Thanks very much. Excited to talk to you. I know it's been really busy within the company, and you recently put out a news release basically updating everyone on where the company's at and really what's ahead. And there's a lot ahead. So let's talk about a number of different things today. First off, you've selected an area within the Permian Basin for this data center campus that you've talked about in the past. So tell us a little bit about sort of the setup for the data center and then the site selection.
Yeah, it's a great question. I mean, obviously, a lot of the, when you talk about Permian Basin and data centers, they don't normally go hand in hand. But I think as we march forward and kind of looking towards a future, it's going to be more synonymous with data center growth. Obviously, data centers, you have to have efficient and reliable energy. And that's what the Permian Basin provides. You know, we're kind of in this glut of natural gas. And so the idea of utilizing natural gas as a fuel source for power generation is kind of a no-brainer. It's been around, the technology's been around for a long time. You know, what we seek to do is really create what they call carbon capture and sequestration. So specifically carbon capture and utilization. So obviously adding that U in there is quite instrumental because it as opposed to just taking the CO2 and then storing it underground and forgetting about it, we intend to utilize that for enhanced oil recovery. And so obviously, I don't know how up to speed your investors are, your readers are on the 45Q carbon credits, but there's a number of factors that play into that 45Q. So you're essentially looking at $60 a ton, for that. Now, of course, that also doesn't imply any sort of value on the CO2 itself per se. But think about just the billions of barrels of unswept oil that exist that would otherwise, just be left, be stranded. So I think, yeah. So really, Steve, that's really kind of how, this AI plays into, increased oil production in the Permian.
And is that why this particular area in general is so strategic, because of just what's available there already and not have to sort of truck in or build in or design, because a lot of it's already ready and in place?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. You want to site your data center in close proximity to existing, dual gas transmission lines. So obviously, your end user, your hyperscaler, is wanting your N plus one. What sort of redundancies do we have to offer, right? So having access to just not just one gas line, but two is great. But also, is there storage capability? That's one. And then of course, ultimately your grid connection is going to be, the holy grail. But, like everyone else, it's how do you differentiate your data center from the hundreds that are being, built across the country? And I truly believe it's the behind the meter strategy that's really going to play into how we differentiate, our SPV, which is called Texas Critical Data Centers, and why this works.
You mentioned AI a little bit, and obviously it's a buzzword or two, if you like, everyone's talking about right now. How important is that going to be, and not only in what you're doing, but also the speed of what you can do it at?
Yeah, I think, there's kind of, and how we're looking at our power strategy is twofold. One is, if you spoke with a hyperscaler, they want it yesterday. And so I think, what that means is, standing up 100, 150 megawatts to get going now, that's not going to include carbon capture. Now, phase two will. Now, because you're talking about a more permanent, facility that's sited, that's permitted appropriately, and that's going to be there for the next 30, 40 years. But I think, ideally, a carbon capture, even though it's not a requirement by the hyperscalers, I think it's a beneficial feature, you know, to understand, you know, what sort of sustainability that we're all looking at.
Okay. Obviously, this is in addition to what the company's doing already, because you still have a key asset in the Pecos Slope Gas Field. So I thought maybe a good opportunity to give us an update on where that's at and sort of what's ahead for the next few months.
Yeah, and I think, you know, to be fair, I think we want to really provide an update to our existing shareholders and future shareholders on where we stand. You know, ideally, you know, we want to be able to adhere to the commencement dates for the helium, which was essentially Q2 of this year. We do have some news that'll be forthcoming here in the next couple of weeks that's going to outline kind of exactly what we want to be sharing with our readers. I know they've been very patient, and it's greatly appreciated, both from the board perspective and management. There's just so much going on right now. It's we just need to be, you know, cognizant on how we release this information. So because it essentially ties in to all what we're doing. So you kind of have the Pecos Slope operations, and how does that tie in into the, you know, the necessary gas required for the AI data center?
Got it. Okay. And lastly, I just want to ask you just about helium in general, and just the fact that we're seeing such a need for it around the world. And, you know, we talked about MRI machines and just the increasing aging population, but also there's so many other uses for it. Are you hearing that as well? People coming to you and saying, you know, just the importance of what you're doing?
Absolutely. I think, you know, when you look at how we're trying to strategically position New Era Helium, it's really across the entire AI spectrum, both from the creation of AI, because when you look at the number one end use application for helium, it is for, you know, semiconductors. And especially with a number of foundries that are being built here domestically, that was part of the CHIPS Act that the Biden administration facilitated. And then, of course, what President Trump is doing, you know, last week, I believe there was SoftBank, you know, initiated a sizable $100 billion investment, or pardon me, it was TSMC, Taiwan Semiconductor Manufacturing, you know, basically committed to $100 billion towards its Phoenix foundry. So you have these different semiconductor foundries that are going in both the Phoenix area, both in Austin, the Ohio Valley, to essentially reshore the semiconductor business, which I think is going to be incredible. So when you start looking at helium, you know, as a net, you know, the U.S. as a net exporter, I would envision over the next 24 months that completely shifting to where it's going to be, you know, staying within the U.S.
Yeah. Well, it's going to be a busy time ahead. I know that. I appreciate your time today in updating us on where you're at. It sounds like we'll be talking again soon in the next couple of weeks as well. So thank you, my friend, and we'll talk soon.
All right, Steve. Hey, thanks for having us on, and look forward to catching up here soon.
All right. Well, great. The CEO of New Era Helium.